Hello, welcome to the Student Services and Wellness Initiatives webinar. I'm Maricela Sanchez, Associate Director of Admissions, and I will be the moderator for today's program. We are joined today by Jenna Abhijit, Director of Academic Administration and Student Affairs, and Michael McGee, President of the Student Bar Association. They will both be highlighting how Chicago Kent is dedicated to providing students the best possible learning environment and to provide you an overview of our student organizations and how you can get involved. I now would like to begin by introducing our panelists. Jenna Abhijit, Director of Academic Administration and Student Affairs at Chicago Kent College of Law. Ms. Abhijit received her BS in Education from North Central College and her MSED in Guidance and Counseling from Eastern Illinois University. She has been at Chicago Kent for 13 years. Jenna currently resides in the city with her husband, Kumar, and her three boys. Michael McGee, President of Student Bar Association. Michael McGee is originally from Detroit, Michigan, and a 2017 graduate of Hampton University. He is currently a 3L at Chicago Kent and serves as the Student Bar Association President. While a student at Chicago Kent, Michael has also actively participated in the Black Law Student Association and the Chicago Kent Trial Team. After graduation in May, Michael will take the New York Bar and begin practice as a Brooklyn Assistant District Attorney. I would now like to turn it over to Jenna.
All right, hello everybody. I'm activating my camera now so you can all see me, but I'm Jenna Abhijit, Director of Academic Administration and Student Affairs, coming to you guys here, you know, as many of you guys are at home as well. But I want to talk to you a little bit about our wellness initiatives and the things that we're really focused on here at Chicago Kent and helping with students. Maybe some of you have had a chance to go to the website, and if not, I would encourage you to do so. But there is a specific website dedicated to wellness at Chicago Kent. And you know, it's important for us to kind of look at all the different dimensions of what it means to be a lawyer. And so in conjunction with the ABA, we have worked to identify a number of different areas that we're focused on. So some of them include social and emotional well-being as well as physical well-being. And I know Michael will talk a little bit about some of later on about some of the initiatives that SBA has put forward as well. But we are really committed here in Student Services and Student Affairs to providing all of these different areas. So a couple of the things that we do have a Brave on Campus program. We do have a number of student organizations that focus on areas of wellness and student well-being. We have services for students for disability accommodations. We also have services for mental health well-being. We have a relationship with the main campus of IIT, and so they provide counselors for us at the downtown campus. But we also have a new initiative that we started this spring with an outside organization called Skylight Consulting. And it allows students a lot more flexibility to meet with a counselor. So they're able to meet Monday through Friday, 9 a.m. to 6 p.m. And they can meet on or off campus. And it's just another resource that we have for students to be able to reach out when they need assistance or talk to somebody when they might need to. Another area that we focus on with students is called the Lawyers Assistance Program. And so these are programs that are throughout the country. They are state-based. So we do have an Illinois Lawyers Assistance Program. And they provide a lot of additional resources for students and for practicing lawyers. So it's an organization that you can continue to participate in once you graduate. They come to the downtown campus during kind of regular semesters. They come to the downtown campus to meet with students once a month, and we are working with them currently to come up with a plan to do some remote kind of calls. And again, it's just another opportunity for students to check in with folks and get questions answered and all of that kind of thing. And I'm just flipping through the other stuff to talk to you guys about a couple more things. You'll see online as well, we have something called the Law School Survival Guide. This is just a list of different resources that you know, you can take advantage of here in the city of Chicago and within Chicago Kent itself. So I would encourage you to check out that. In addition, we have a number of different kind of mentoring opportunities and faculty advisor opportunities that would be presented, you know, once you would start classes. But the mentor program, we allow incoming students to sign up even before you come in the fall, to be paired up with an upper level student. And the connection begins over the summer so that you can reach out to these students and get insight from them already about how to prepare, what kind of things to look for, where should you live in the city, a number of different things that you can do. And I think that's kind of all I've got for now. I might pass it over to Michael. We also have some programming that focuses on wellness. There it is, awesome. So we also have some programming that we have started really this year and have pushed to really focus on things for students. You'll see the Coffee Talk Wednesdays. We've worked with a bunch of upper level students and with the SBA, our Student Bar Association, to do some coffees throughout the semester that allowed 1Ls to come in and talk to upper level students in a kind of informal way, ask a lot of questions. For the spring, things have taken a change, as everybody knows, but we are working on some virtual coffees to set up right now so that students can log in and get the same kind of connection and ask the same kind of questions for folks. The Mindful Mondays was a set of programming opportunities that we did throughout the semester in the lobby of the building and just allowed people to come and do some coloring or do some puzzles or build stress balls. But again, just another way of connecting with each other. In the fall is National Mental Health Awareness Day, and the ABA, as well as the law school, do a number of different programs throughout to kind of help people focus. We did some passive programming in the building with posters of how to, different things that you can do to help you relax or building a schedule, all of that kind of stuff. We also, one of the other things that we have is the academic support program. And it's just an opportunity to get involved with the teaching assistants and different programs that we do throughout the year focused on helping you to prepare for your exams, helping you to prepare for that first day of class and a lot of different stuff. And from here, I'll pass it over to Michael.
Okay, hi everybody. As Marcella said, my name is Mike. I am the current Chicago Kent SBA president. And so just some of the things that we do in regard to mental health through the SBA was we worked along with Jenna's offices, Student Services, to bring back Family and Friends Day, which was an opportunity for all law school students at Chicago Kent to bring their families, whether it's their spouses, their children, their parents, to the law school. And they sat through a variation of panels, whether it was student panels, professor panels, as well as, I believe, criminal law and IP mini classes. And the overall, the goal was to immerse the families into the law school experience, just so they can kind of see what the law student and their family goes through on a day-to-day and what it is exactly they're aiming toward with their goals. Even further, I know Jenna touched on Mindful Mondays, which is an opportunity every other Monday, sponsored by respective student organizations, to just give students an opportunity to kind of go drift into the lobby, take their minds off of the stresses of law school. But then another big challenge that we had this year was the CK Fitness Challenge. And so that was an opportunity to kind of actually unite not just the students, but also the faculty and the staff at Chicago Kent. And so we had different components to the fitness challenge, which were a running challenge. So between beginning runners, expert runners, as well as people who just wanted to simply walk for exercise. And so basically the goal was to get everyone out to, give them some sort of motivation, but then also to build a sort of camaraderie among the student body and the faculty and staff. The top two people in each category received gift cards. And so it actually had a really great turnout. It was something that we hoped to expand on in the spring, but unfortunately weren't able to. But then also Jenna mentioned mentorship programs. And those are something that's done within the overall school through Jenna's office, but also through the respective student organizations. A lot of those organizations consist of the Black law students, Hispanic law students, China law, and then we also have some that are split based on professional interests. So we have criminal law, we have intellectual property, and then we also have organizations such as Kent Justice Foundation and the National Lawyers Guild. So each of the respective student organizations also have their own separate mentorship programs that usually start in the fall at the beginning of 1L year, either pairing a 1L with a 2 or a 3L, who more so not just aligns with their interests or their backgrounds, but also professional goals as well. And so I think with that, I'll turn it back over to Maricela.
Great. Thank you, Michael and Jenna, for that valuable information. Michael, I actually wanted to ask you if you could share at this time some of the student organizations that students can become involved in, and maybe some of the benefits of getting involved.
I mentioned a few of them, BALSA, HILSA, we have the Irish American Law Student Association, we have the Disability Advocacy Law Student Association, and so there's a wide variety, honestly, whether it relates to people's individual backgrounds or even, like I say, your professional goals. And so, honestly, the benefit of that comes in networking overall. I know from my own personal experience, most of the jobs that I had came through networking with either professors, but then also there were a few students who helped me. I know one upperclassman who I actually met through the Office of Admissions, she helped me get a judicial externship my 2L year. And so networking is a huge benefit that comes with joining these student organizations. But then also, when you go to law school, you know, it's kind of like a different scale from what it is in undergrad. These are people who are going to be more specifically a part of your career, and more likely than not, they'll be your colleagues, whether you work at the same firm, whether you work at competing firms, you know, so it's always great to kind of get to out there to know the legal community and build those relationships. And you never know what they can offer.
Mike, with that being said, can you please give us like an overview of what SBA is and what they do for students?
Yes, so the SBA is essentially the student government for the law school. And so primarily we serve as a bridge between the students and the faculty and staff, but then also we put out different programmings throughout the year. So this year we focus a lot of our programmings on mental health, as well as community service. Those are actually two ad hoc committees that we started at the beginning of the year. And with them being ad hoc committees, they consist of individuals from both SBA as well as the general student body. Beside that, we put out various social events too. So we do the back to school bash at the beginning of the fall and the spring semester. We do a Convisor bash, which is just a party, which is co-sponsored with Richard Convisor, who's the founder of Barbie and one of the professors at Chicago Kent. But then even outside of that, we work hand in hand with the faculty and staff to really address a lot of the issues that go on within the law school. And obviously due to our current climate, how to adjust and transition to our current circumstances with COVID-19 was one of the primary tasks that we worked with the faculty to address as far as with the student body concerns and moving forward.
One of the things that I would add as well is that one of the key takeaways that I would want everyone to get from this is that we are really committed to the overall wellness of our students and making sure that you graduate and you become successful lawyers and that you are successful law school students. And if, you know, it means coming up with new things or adjusting, as Michael said, as we are to current situations, making sure students have a voice, making sure that students have an opportunity to share things and to get the resources and things that they need. That's our main priority, and that's what we're here to do.
Great. Thank you, Jenna, for that information. Could you also provide us, Jenna, with kind of an overview of what you do for orientation and the types of activities that you have for the students that week?
Sure. So our orientation is a little unlike a lot of law schools' orientation sessions. It's 4 days, and during these 4 days, we are going to get you into your classes already. So you're either generally going to do your first class sessions of criminal law, or for some sections, it might be torts. You're also going to have classes of your legal writing course as well. So we kind of want you to take that opportunity to kind of jump in before classes really get started and get a feel for how things are going to go. It's to help you get better prepared. We're going to focus on a lot of different areas. We're going to look at things about professionalism, things about student wellness, financial aid. We do a number of different activities to get you acclimated to the building, to do library tours, to help you kind of see where things are. We, within the first week of class, we'll have the student activity fair. So that'll be a chance to get to see what kind of activities and things you can get involved with. We do a number of different panel discussions, one focused on diversity and what diversity means and how it's represented at Chicago Kent. We look at opportunities to bring alumni back to talk to you about what their experiences are and how they have transitioned. And we bring our teaching assistants involved as well to talk about issues of academic support and things that we can do to help you prepare for your classes and how to start studying and how to start looking at this adjustment. Because like Michael mentioned, law school is going to be different than your undergraduate experience. And we're here to help you make it through those adjustments. So we throw a lot at you in those 4 days, the purpose of it is to kind of help you to jump in while you still have a hand to hold. And then we'll let you go after that, but we'll still be in touch.
Great, thank you, Jenna, for this really great information. Michael, is there anything else that you would like to add? If not,
I was just making sure that you can hear me. Yes, I mean, overall, I mean, like Jenna said, you know, Chicago Kent, from my experience, kind of being almost on the other end of it now, as a 3L soon to be out of here, Chicago Kent has definitely, each year, you know, there's been different circumstances. It's definitely shown in various ways that it's committed to student health, student wellness, but then also succeeding on the academic level through the different opportunities that they provided. And so I loved my experience, and so I'm definitely willing to share any aspect of it to those who are interested.
Great. Well, at this time, I'm sure many of you have questions, and I'd like to take the time to open up the floor for those questions. So as you will see, please use the questions box in the webinar software to ask your question. And then I'll pull the questions as you begin asking them. And just to get this started, Michael, can you describe the campus setting? Would you say it's a competitive atmosphere? Is there anything that you would like to kind of like let our attendees know at this time?
I will say that it is competitive. It's very, I mean, it's not really different from most other law schools in the fact that there is that competitive nature when it comes to grades succeeding, primarily 1L year. But the way in which we differ is that it's a very respectful competitiveness. It's and a large amount of camaraderie among the law school, among the different grades, the 1Ls, things like that. And it's the type of environment that's honestly fostered and encouraged by the students, as well as the faculty and staff. So, you know, even though we all know we're competing against each other, there's never any ill will or any ill intention that I've experienced or that I've heard of. And then even in times, and you know, keep referring back to times like this, you know, it really just shows the character of a lot of the students and how willing they are to reach out and to help one another, whether it's in types of crises like this or even in normal times and just looking out for one another. You know, I remember when I was a 1L, I think I literally just had a day where I was like really stressed and I was like, okay, I'm just gonna take today to myself and not go to school. And I remember it was like sometime first semester, I got like a few calls, texts, and even some of the professors emailed me asking where I was because they genuinely cared. They knew that I wasn't the type to just naturally miss class. So that's just one example that we do, there is that competitive nature there, but it's also a very welcoming, encouraging, and healthy environment overall.
Great, thank you, Michael. Well, we have a question.
Okay. Oh, sorry. No, I was just gonna say, I would point out as well, the pictures, right? This idea of seeing the pictures of the campus and kind of getting a feel for it. The irony is I look at these pictures and I'm thinking, wow, I haven't been back there, you know, in such a long time because we've all been confined and I'm missing it. And I'm seeing these pictures of our building And I'm noticing that this kind of represents the real life in this building. People stop to talk to each other on the stairs. People stop and sit in the chairs and get to talk to one another, and they hang out together in the cafeteria or in the student game room. So the atmosphere as well, just with inside the building itself, is also, you know, it's going to help you get through those tough times. It's going to help you get through those classes, because you're going to be able to walk outside of that classroom and then into a area of soft chairs that you guys can sit and kind of process through what just happened in that lecture, or what's going on, you know, and it, just seeing these pictures was just a nice reminder of what actually happens in our building. So I wanted to point that out for folks too.
Thank you, Jenna. I feel the same way. I definitely feel that looking at these photos as well is a great reminder to all of us, right, of just the atmosphere and how people are, and just how our students engage as well. Actually, there is a question that did come in for you, Jenna. Would you please discuss any differences in scheduling of the orientation for part-time students? And does Chicago Kent anticipate that this year's orientation will be in person or online?
Sure. We haven't made a decision about in-person or online. We're functioning at this point with everything being in person and kind of going as it normally progress. But I think that is subject to change at any time. With regards to part-time students, I'm not sure if you're wondering about part-time or evening students, but for the evening student program orientation, it still is the 4 days, and it happens in the evening. So it'll be from kind of 6 to usually around 9, 9:30. And again, we try to incorporate as much of kind of the sessions. We focus on the diversity panel, kind of the alumni panel, and we do have a number of other things built into the session, as well as, you know, our meeting with OTS, with our Office of Technology Services, our RTS, and we have you take your classes as well. So I think that's the key point, is that you will participate in the classes. For students who we do have very few students who are in kind of the part-time day program, the expectation for those folks is that you would attend the day part of orientation. I hope that answers it.
Yes, it does. And then also, can you kind of go over a little more about the academic support program that you have for our 1L students?
Sure. So, yeah, of course. We have what's called our academic support program. So all incoming students in your 1L courses, you will have a teaching assistant, and that teaching assistant is a student who has taken the class before with that professor. So they really have a good idea of how that professor teaches, what kind of things they're looking at for answers from students, what kind of things they're looking for on the exams. And so that teaching assistant we'll work with the students to do review sessions. If there's a midterm or just kind of a mid-semester review, a review for the end of the end of the semester right before exams. Those TAs also do office hours, which are a chance for anybody from the class to meet with the TA to ask questions and to kind of further, you know, their understanding of different concepts or things that might have gone on in the class. There is another component, which is called our small group sessions. This is a subsection of the larger class. Students can be invited, or they can petition into the program itself. And each week, these students, the smaller group, which is usually about between 12 to 15 students, meet with the teaching assistant so that the teaching assistant can focus more on, especially in the fall, kind of skills building. Some of the activities that they might do in these small group sessions involve meeting during the lecture and having the TA take notes and then having the students take notes. And then in that small group session, comparing those notes so that the TAs can start helping the students to really see what they should be pulling out of the lectures. Teaching assistants do help with building outlines. They do help with additional hypotheticals or kind of drilling through different ideas and points. But the focus is not to reteach the session. So we will, you know, we will send out some invites to the program. The invites are based on a number of different things, such as undergraduate GPA and where you went to school and what your undergraduate major was, how long you've been out of school. So there's a number of different things, and getting an invitation into the program has nothing to do with your ability to be a successful law school student. If you've been accepted, obviously we think you're going to be a successful law school student. It's just another opportunity to get some additional support. We also open up the program to students who want to petition into it, so that anybody at any stage can be involved in the small group sessions. In the fall, we also do a number of large group presentations, including during orientation, it will be how to prepare for your classes, and Professor Kari Johnson puts that program on. We also do a session on outlining and how to build your outline and how to plan for your outline. We share some examples of some outlines that have worked well, and the teaching assistants come from those too. And then we do a final presentation about how to prepare for your exams and how you should be studying and different things that you can do. So it's kind of an ongoing program that we really focus on throughout the year.
Great, thank you, Jenna. There's another question that came in for you. You mentioned Brave on Campus, and I'm just curious if you can elaborate a little bit more on that program and what it entails.
Sure. So it's fundamentally our safe space program. So it is, we do training for staff and faculty who participate in the program. And online is a list of those faculty and staff members and students who have identified themselves as folks who, represent a safe space on campus or a place for students to share ideas and to talk about questions or things that they might be going through or to get resources or different advice. And we've made it kind of this broader idea of Brave on Campus, to allow students to know that they can come and talk about anything in these safe spaces.
Great. And as far as you had also mentioned, are there any are there any additional fees for meeting with counselors of Skylight Consulting, or are these wellness programs built in the tuition and fees? If you can elaborate a little bit more on that as well.
Sure, of course. All the counseling services are free to students. It's part of what you pay for your tuition. They're provided from the university as a whole, and so those are the things that we have for you, as well as the Lawyer's Assistance Program, again, a free service that you can take advantage of at the downtown campus. With regards to kind of bigger stuff, when you do become a student, when you are enrolled with at least one credit hour starting in the fall, you are automatically enrolled into the student health insurance. And so if you wanted to check out any more information about that, the information is online as to what coverage is and how much it is and if you want it for dependents. And we talk about that a little bit more as we get through. But if you're thinking about how your health insurance might transition into the fall as well, you can check that all out online.
Great, thank you, Jenna. as far as the gym, there is a question that did come in. A student would like to know if does the gym offer access to gym for physical wellness, things like that. So if you want to talk a little bit about of that as well.
I know that it's in the works. So the fitness center will be downstairs in the concourse level of the building. I do know that it is under construction, even though the building is closed at this time, they are still working on it. But it will have, and the talk is how it will be rolled out to folks, but students will have access to it. And the hope is that we have the ability to really use it to do some more programming as opposed to just a place for students to go and work out, but to perhaps do, we have a group of students who do yoga up on our seventh floor in an open space. The hope is to be able to continue to do some types of things like that and have another place for students to do so.
Thank you for that information, Jenna. What are some things that students do to relax? Does the school offer social opportunities?
I maybe can hand that off to Michael. I think he's probably got more of the enjoyable social opportunities. But there are always things to do on campus and off campus.
Yeah, so some of the social activities that SBA does, as I mentioned before, it's the back to school bash that typically happens sometime early September and then early January. And it's usually at Fat Pork Tap Works, which is the local bar. They do the $20 all you can drink deal. So we usually sponsor that each year. Outside of that, we also do the Convisor Bash. We do the Barrister's Ball, which is always huge deals. But even outside of that, we also do, they're like a different smaller events that happen throughout the year. We've tried to shift focus this year, not just to the drinking activities, but then also the non-drinking, to make sure that we accommodate and are welcome to the entire student body. But then even outside of the sponsor activities, Chicago Hemp also has the game room, which is on the fifth floor of the school. That's 24-hour access to all students. So whoever want to go in there, a lot of times, respective organizations or maybe certificate programs, they will host, you know, different social gatherings there. Typically when SBA holds elections, we'll do a lot of our social events there to kind of like meet the candidates. So there are various events that go on throughout the school year. Focusing more on some of the student organizations each year, the Kent Justice Foundation, they do the spring silent auction. And that's an opportunity for students to go and auction off for different activities or prizes. Some of them include maybe, I think like a baseball game with Judge Erickson, who's one of the professors there. Some professors will do, you know, wine nights or bowling events, but then also students contribute different prizes. So those are some of the, like the different social gatherings that we do have. We typically have them year round, and it's usually always something to do either in the building or off campus.
Michael, can you talk more about SBA events? Mm-hmm.
So with SBA, as I mentioned, Barrister's Ball is always a huge one. This year, unfortunately, had to be canceled. It was going to be at the Palmer House. But then outside of that, what we focused on were community service as well. That was the second part of our one of our ad hoc committees that we started this year. And so with the community service, we primarily focused on building engagement, not just within the Chicago Kent community, but overall Chicago. And so one of the main events we did this year, well, it was in the fall, was go to the Juvenile Temporary Detention Center. And so there are youths there from about 17 and younger. And so the day we went there, we took about 30 students from Chicago Kent. We sponsored food to feed both the youth and the students from Chicago Kent. And essentially it was a mentoring thing. We don't really talk to them about, you know, their current situation, but primarily just who they are as people, what they like to do, whether in their current situations at the center or when they're back home, and kind of what they want to do when they grow up. And so one of the fun things we were able to do while at the detention center was be a part of their radio program, which is something that it's one of those like social activities that they're focusing on internally. And so they have two students who act as radio hosts and they interview their different special guests. So some of our students were able to be special guests for their show that day. And so it was really a great event because it really gave us opportunity to see what that aspect of the system was like. And really just hear their stories, get to know who they are as people, but then also they enjoy hearing our stories, how we, you know, are working to be attorneys and what we want to do as we progress through law school. So that was one of the main things that we did. Outside of that, we also did the different mental health events, as well as worked with the Cabrini Legal Aid group to really just work on marijuana case expungements. Which is something that's been very high, especially with the more legalization of marijuana in the different states. So those are some things that we worked on this year.
Mike, what would you say your favorite event this year was and why?
That's
a big question.
I'll say one of my favorite events was actually the one that was put on by the Black Law Student Association during Black History Month. It was, I think it was a continuation of an event that they started last year, which was My Black is Beautiful. And so what they actually did was they brought in local artists. So none of them were law students. They were all just local Chicago artists, whether it was poetry, whether it was portraits, things like that. And so we got to see their talent on the stage. It was hosted in the auditorium, and there was a kind of a social mixer outside of the auditorium in the lobby afterward. And so just really kind of having that Chicago engagement overall, because I'm not from here. And so I always love the opportunity to just become more immersed in the overall community and see a lot of the talent and artistry that's out there. So that was something that we were able to do, that I was able to attend, and I really enjoyed it. Outside of that, I would also say the SBA Holiday Fest. I actually planned it last year. This year I passed it on to someone else and they planned it and did an amazing job, but that's always fun. And so that's one of the opportunities where all of the student organizations come together. They host food in the lobby, SBA sponsors the bar, and then we also do a DJ. So there's usually Christmas music or just different types of other music that wants to be played. And so that's just really an opportunity for us all to come together right before fall semester finals start. Get free food, hang out, talk to each other. And I would say that's honestly one of the most fun events, but also the one where you see a lot of the camaraderie, when you see the different student organizations come together, putting on this one event, and kind of just like repping their different backgrounds and areas. So I always love the Holiday Fest.
Thank you, Mike. And can you also kind of elaborate on just the fact that you're not from Chicago, and just how you adjusted to moving to Chicago, and any recommendations you can make for those that are on today who will be moving to Chicago to attend ChicagoCon?
Yeah. So I guess my advice would be, as far as moving to Chicago, do your best to connect with students, with current students. Learn about their living situations, learn what worked for them and what didn't. As far as my situation, it kind of worked out very well because I, have a roommate who's one of my best friends from college, and so we started law school together, and her family's from Chicago. So they knew the area really well, live in the Hyde Park area, which is a really nice area, and then also it's a very easy commute from our apartment to Chicago camp. It takes only about one bus, maybe 30 minutes, which isn't bad in my opinion. I would definitely, encourage you to reach out to students, whether it's through platforms like this or even through admissions, and see who they would be able to put you in contact with as far as the living situation, and kind of just see, where the good places are as far as the commute. How far will the commute be? How much is rent? The quality of living? Are there grocery stores around? So just really picking their brains about just the day-to-day things that really take into account when moving to a new city. But my overall transition was pretty good because even going to Chicago, as I started to meet a lot of people, a lot of my, friends that I met, not all of them were from Chicago, but a few of them had still visited Chicago in the past, whether it was coming down for like a month or a summer, or they lived like in Indiana or things like that. So they already had some sort of like background knowledge more than I had. And so, they were able to give me tips when it came to the CTA, or when it came to good places to eat, good grocery stores to go to, but then also, in the areas they didn't really know, we were able to explore together. So I think one of the other big pieces of advice I will offer is always be open. You never know what some great places are to find, what some good traditions are to start. So just always be open and finding time to do new things, especially during 1L year. It's such a stressful time that, it's really important to make sure you find that social life balance. And really just get out there, and exploring a new city like Chicago is one of the best ways.
Thank you for that, Michael. Jen and Mike, can you guys both kind of give your, just kind of some advice to our incoming 1L students, anything that you would recommend at this time for them?
I think building off of what Mike said, be prepared to push yourself. Be prepared to change your perspective, and be prepared to learn a lot of new things. We can come into, the situation with these preconceived notions about what we think law school is going to be about, or what we think Chicago is going to be about. or, you know, what we think our peers are going to be like. And it's fine. It's great to have that mindset built in of what your expectations already are. But don't get that too ingrained in who you are going to become as a student and who you're going to become as a lawyer, as a practicing lawyer. Because the whole process is about taking in all of this new information and meeting all of these new people and learning all of these new resources and ways of doing things, and then helping that and letting that change who you are. Not from the inside out, of course, but letting that kind of develop you into this kind of larger person that you're going to become, and the way that you are going to go out and help people, and the way that you're going to go out and interact with folks and how you're going to build those relationships. This is a definite changing period for a lot of people. I would say 99% of people. You know, it's not what you see on the TV, right? Especially law school. You know, nobody's really showing you what it's like to be a full law school student. But again, we're here to help you be successful in whatever fashion that is for you. And it's not going to be the same for everybody. So just always know if things come up or you have questions, we're here to help facilitate that and to help you grow as a person and to help you graduate and be successful.
Yeah, and I will say also just kind of where you are now, don't get so bogged down in the aspect of the fact that you're going to law school in the fall to the point where you can't really, you know, enjoy where you are now. Whether you're, you know, working, whether you're maybe traveling, or maybe you're just spending time with family, you know, enjoy where you are now and take life as it comes. And then eventually when you do get to law school, understand, especially here in Chicago, Kent, that you're going to learn so much. Whether it's both into the black letter law, but then also just like your way of thinking, and it's going to shift so much. And so one of the biggest pieces of advice I can give in that regard is that, you know, focus on the classroom aspect, but also take every opportunity you can learn outside of the classroom. Whether it's through the trial team, whether it's through moot court, whether it's through, you know, alternative dispute resolution, whether it's through just going to different networking events and meeting different attorneys and judges, and learning from their experiences. You know, just take every opportunity you can, because that's what law school overall is about. It's about your professional and personal development, and really just learning so much that the law has to offer, but then also what you can contribute to the law. So
thank you, Jenna. Thank you, Michael, for sharing all of this wonderful information today. With that being said, we appreciate you joining us today for today's presentation. If you have any remaining questions, please do not hesitate to contact the Office of Admissions by phone or email. We are also happy to put you in touch with students, faculty, and alumni.